JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for November the 5th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against most of the other major currencies on Thursday during the Asian session Friday. It gained the most versus the British pound, the Kiwi and the Aussie, while it underperformed only against the Japanese yen. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Swiss franc. Now, the strengthening of the US dollar and the other safe havens, yen and franc, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that markets turn to risk-off trading at some point yesterday or today in Asia. The pound has also been acting as a risk-correlated currency lately, but yesterday's weakness was the result of the Bank of England outcome rather than the outcome of the overall market sentiment. Turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that all but one of the major EU and US indices traded in the green. The only exception was Dow Jones, which slid 0.09%. The S&P 500 and the Nasdaq hit fresh record highs for another day. That said, sentiment softened during the Asian trading once again, and with no apparent trigger, we stick to our guns that this is due to the uncertainty surrounding the Chinese economy and its property sector. Now, the reason why equities may have continued drifting north this week may be the less hawkish than anticipated central banks. Remember that on Tuesday, the RBA signaled that it could start raising interest rates in 2023 sooner than its previous estimate of 2024. But the market was already more aggressive, betting that Australia's rates will hit or surpass 1% by the end of 2022. On Wednesday, the Fed began its tapering process as expected, but maintained the transitory wording in the accompanying statement, while Fed Chair Powell said that they will stay patient on interest rates. Last but not least, yesterday we had the Bank of England, which refrained from pushing the hike button, even as prior remarks by its officials led market participants to assign an 80% chance to such an action, at least according to the UK overnight index swaps forward yield curve. What's more, British policymakers now noted that it will be necessary over coming months to increase the bank rate in order to return inflation sustainably to the 2% target. This means that they may not hike in December either. February is still in the coming months spectrum. That's why we saw the pound falling around 180 pips against its US counterpart. It was not only the decision to keep interest rates unchanged, but it was also the 7-2 vote in favor of doing so, and the coming months narrative, which suggests that policymakers may delay a potential rate liftoff beyond the end of this year. We would expect the pound to stay underselling interest for a while, more especially against the Kiwi, due to the RBNZ being the most hawkish among the major central banks, but also against the US dollar, despite Fed Chair Powell signaling patience on interest rate increases. Remember, yesterday we said that, in our view, the committee appeared more concerned on inflation and also kept the door for rate hikes starting next year wide open, which could allow the US dollar to strengthen again. clearer remarks or hints that interest rates could indeed start rising after the tapering is over may allow traders to buy more US dollars. Speaking about the Fed and the US dollar, today the main event on the financial agenda may be the US employment report for October. Non-farm payrolls are forecast to have rebounded 450,000 after falling to 194,000 in September, while the unemployment rate is expected to have ticked down to 4.7% from 4.8%. Average hourly earnings are expected to have slowed somewhat on a monthly basis to 0.4% from 0.6%, but the year-over-year rate is forecast to have risen to 4.9% from 4.6%. Overall, the numbers point to a decent report and may encourage market participants to bring forth their Fed hike expectations. According to the Fed Fund futures, they anticipate the first 25 basis points hike to be delivered in September next year. All this could encourage more dollar buying, but the tricky question is how will the stock market respond? Will it slide due to expectations of faster rate hikes, which could hurt profitability of firms, or will it rise on signs that the US economy is performing better than many may have recently feared due to the latest supply shortages? In our view, although the former has been the case in the past, we believe that lately it's been the latter. Thus, we expect decent jobs data to help stocks drift further north. Now, as for the rest of today's events, at the same time with the US NFPs, we get the employment report for October from Canada as well. Expectations are for the unemployment rate to have slid to 6.8% from 6.9%, but for the net change in employment to show that the economy has added fewer jobs than in September. Now, with the Bank of Canada unexpectedly ending its quantitative easing program last week, officials may now scratch their heads on when the appropriate time for a rate increase may be. The financial world anticipates such a move early next year, and in our view, a slowdown in jobs growth for just a month is unlikely to change that, especially if the unemployment rate indeed slides. Now, we will also get to hear from four central bank officials, and those are ECB Vice President Luis de Guindos, ECB Executive Board Member Fabio Panetta, Bank of England MPC Member Dave Ramsden, and Bank of England MPC Member Silvana Denreiro. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, a greater weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.